thought it might, I might tell you one or two anecdotes with which highlights my father's career. His time in the House of Commons was cut short by the sudden death of my paternal grandfather just before the 1945 post-war election. However, he is one of the few members of Parliament to have made his maiden speech in reply to the Loyal Address in 1944. I think some of you will remember that there was an outcry when the Russians demanded Field Marshal von Manstein be handed over by the British for his supposed atrocities when he commanded on the Eastern Front. The British and Americans refused to put von Manstein on trial themselves. The American British refused to put von Manstein on trial themselves in 1949, 4 years after the end of the war, in Hamburg, despite the reservations of the legality of such proceedings. He was acquitted on all of the 8 most serious charges, but convicted on lesser or modified charges, and was sentenced to 18 years, later reduced, and he was released in 1953. Mr. Robert Paget, QC MP, defended him without payment, and his junior counsel was Sam Silkin, later QC MP, a Jew. My father and General the Lord Bridgman raised a fund to pay for his fair defence. One of the first donations came from Sir Winston Churchill. I think this demonstrates perfectly my father's commitment to fair play and the rights of the individual, which influenced his later establishment in partnership with Norris and Ross McWhirter of the Freedom Association in 1975. When the Chief of the Air Staff heard my father was to be appointed Secretary of State for Air, he told the private secretary, permanent secretary, sorry, that he would not be told what to do by a guardsman. The instant reply from the permanent secretary was that my father was not only a guardsman, but also a chartered accountant. On taking up his appointment, he was told by Lord Trenchard, the father of the Royal Air Force, that he should not only ask for the Air Marshal's views, but also ask the advice of the pilots. He followed this up by learning to fly and going in a Canberra night bomber on a high altitude photo reconnaissance mission over northern Russia, which got him into hot water with the Prime Minister, your grandfather, on his return. As you would have read, my father and mother first visited Australia in 1955. On their return, they gave me a copy of Frank Hurley's photographic book on Australia, which immediately fired my imagination to want to visit Australia. You can imagine my immense pleasure, mixed with some pride, when the Queen appointed my father Governor General in 1961, and I was able to realise my dream, aged only 16. All Australians were most welcoming to us all, and I think it was the Australian Women's Weekly who named us collectively as the On Poms, which my father thought very funny until we reminded him that this made him the right On Pom. Finally, I would like to add a postscript to the notes you have been given. The bronze naiad statue given to Australia by my father sits on the landing stage at Government House overlooking Lake Burley Griffin. My father later commissioned a copy of the naiad to be placed in the Magnolia Garden at Penzance in memory of my mother, who died in at Yarralumla on the 15th of November 1962, aged 48. The inscription around the base reads, "Mutis Amo Amanta," a couplet penned by Catullus, which was later used by Sir Philip Sidney as the basis for his poem, "My True Love Have My Heart, and I Have His." This statue was dedicated just 6 weeks before my father suffered his fatal stroke. This year, I have commissioned my nephew, Robert Rattray, to make a statue of an archer, which follows a poem by Sidney, which will also act as a sun dial. My son, the current Philip Sidney, who is about to embark on a doctorate in English at Cambridge, will write a sonnet devoted to his grandfather. And later this year, we hope to dedicate the sun dial to mark the centenary of my father's birth. Well, Dad, I hope that wasn't too embarrassing. Thank you all for listening to me.